and welcome to the Graduate School of Education's first public talk in spring 2020. We are very proud and honored to actually have our esteemed professor, Dr. Gillian Roehrig from the University of Minnesota, and who is actually a professor of STEM education. And her talk today is titled The Development of STEM Schools in the United States, International Implications. There's also another talk on Wednesday, so put that in your calendar if you're available from 5 to 7. And the title of that talk is Promoting STEM Identity for Female Students in STEM. Once again, I'm so honored to have Dr. Gillian with us today, and we'll give the floor to her for her presentation. And we'll also have some time for some questions at the end of the talk.
Okay. Thank you, Mohammed.
Exactly. I was going to say, I know who that is.
I didn't even have to look. All right. Well, thank you, everybody, for being here. It's a privilege to get a chance to talk to you all. And hopefully, I get to hear a little bit from you all as well. And we can stimulate some conversation and some questions. So, all right. So for those of you who are not as familiar with the U.S., I know when I moved to the United States, I kind of had to look at a map and say, where am I moving to again? So this is Minnesota up here, where I live now. I've been there for 14 years, right up by the Canadian border. And I work at the University of Minnesota. The University of Minnesota is the third largest public university in the United States. We have 55,000 students on our campus, about 40,000 undergraduates and 15,000 graduate students. So we're a very, very large campus. It's a beautiful campus if you ever visit, particularly in the summer. If you look on our website, you'll see that most of the photos are from the summer, and there's a reason for that, because when I left on Thursday, it looked a little bit more like that. It was about minus 5 degrees Celsius. And so when everyone keeps asking me, aren't you cold, because I don't have my winter coat on, the answer is no. I'm quite delightfully warm here, thank you very much. So that's where I'm from. And we'll talk today about a couple of STEM schools that are in Minnesota. And we'll share some of their journey towards becoming a STEM school. And hopefully that will sort of resonate with some of the work and issues here with the STEM schools in Egypt. So, why do we do STEM? So, I'll give you the United States perspective, and I know from traveling to a lot of other countries that it's often some very similar reasons that we see. So, the main conversation in the U.S. is about workforce demands, right? The issue is that, and this data is old now, right? We're in 2020, all right? But the decades, as we look forward, is going to be very similar, that as we look at growth in all occupations, the STEM fields have higher and higher growth potential, particularly in the areas of computer science and the medical fields. Biomedical engineering is one of the biggest growth professions that we have right now. And the problem is, simply, we don't have enough engineers and scientists to fill these positions. And so STEM has become the way that we're trying to think about that. And to sort of capture that problem, we think about it in the U.S. as being an issue with what we call the STEM pipeline. So if you think about your students of 5, 6 years old who are entering this pipeline, some of them make it all the way through a 4-year degree in engineering or science, right? But we lose students along the way for a variety of different reasons. And so part of our work as researchers and teachers is to think about how can we stop that loss of students in the pipeline. And to give you an idea as to how severe that problem is, I'll share just a few numbers with you as well. So each year in the United States, roughly 4 million students enter ninth grade in high school, okay, throughout the country. And for a variety of reasons, some of them drop out, some of them don't take the math classes or maybe the language classes that they need to. But of those, only about 1.3 million are considered college ready at the point when they graduate and exit high school. Out of that 1.3 million students, only 278,000 choose to major in a STEM field. So physics, math, engineering, various degrees like that. And not all of them finish. Some of those drop out. Some of them change their major. They switch to poetry, communications, who knows what, right? Different things. So I'll do the math for you, so you don't have to think about math this late in the day. That's just around about 4% of students, right, who enter ninth grade and end up getting a 4-year degree in STEM. It's nowhere near the number of students that we need to fill all those jobs. The other problem that we have is if we look at who's leaking out of this pipeline and why they're leaking, it really depends. It depends on your background. It might depend on your income status. It might depend on your gender. It might depend on your ethnicity. So one of the other issues that we try to address is how can we increase diversity in STEM? Okay, because we need to get more women and we need to get more of our students of color into STEM professions if we're going to fill these workforce needs. This is just some quick data, and we'll talk about this more in a couple of days, so I'm not going to talk too much about some of the gender issues. But this is all of the degrees awarded in the United States, and that what you'll see there is, actually, I take that back, this is all the degrees in STEM fields. So you're going to see there's a large proportion of men compared to the women who are in green. In some areas, like biology, the women slightly outpace the men. But look at computer science. Look at engineering. Right? We have a huge disparity with women going into those fields. And so as we start to think about STEM, we want to think about what can we do to change that equation. If we're going to get more engineers in the field, we better start getting some women in. Otherwise, we're not going to make those numbers up. And in the US, where we have a very diverse population, we also need to think about the ethnic background of the students going in. And this looks at two-year degrees, and this looks at four-year degrees. So we'll just take a look, quick look at the four-year degrees. The number of white students getting STEM degrees slightly is a higher percentage than in the population as a whole. But if you look at our Asian, Black, and Hispanic students, they are far less positioned in STEM than they are in the population at large. So we do a lot of work with trying to increase the diversity in those fields. In fact, if you look at the engineering profession, so the people who make it out of a four-year degree and actually become professional engineers, 87% of engineers are white, and about 75% are white males. So we have a lot of work to do with increasing diversity and getting more people out into the field. So workforce and increase in diversity. And then another argument that we see a lot, and you'll see it written down and maybe a little less attended to in our schools, is STEM literacy. So thinking about how do we get a citizenry who are informed about STEM and who can make good decisions, whether it's about public policy issues that we might vote about, things like that. And I thought I'd give you a slightly different perspective here. This is the Japanese perspective. I've had the pleasure of working quite closely with faculty at Shizuoka University in Japan, who are starting to develop a STEM program and some STEM schools over in their country. And they think about it in terms of this preparing for what they call Society 5.0. And so they think about our history of humankind as starting off as a hunting society, developing systematic ways of agriculture. Then we have the Industrial Revolution, right? And we have a huge area at the end of the 18th century here, right, moving into the industrial society. Then with the advent of computers and the internet, we're currently in this information society, right? You've all got your phone, we all Google everything, right? We don't know how to use a map anymore if we have to get anywhere, right? We're very much in this space. But as we start to think about artificial intelligence, the Internet of Things, big data, we've got an aging population, right? How are we going to support ourselves? How are we going to feed the people we have on the planet without destroying our planet? How are we going to deal with social justice? We have so many issues that we have to think about. So we're preparing for this new society. We're not sure what it'll look like, but as we think about robots and automation, we know it's going to look different. And so that means we have to start to think about STEM literacy a little bit differently. And if we break that down a little bit and think about where we're at in terms of the digital era, it's the internet in the mid-90s. For those of you who are on Instagram and Facebook and all of those things, right, that's our social media age here. Very much moving now into this collaborative economy age, right? I was doing some work with Mohammed earlier and we had a Google Doc open, right? Right, that's how we work together. We can work across countries, across time boundaries, right, in that collaborative space. We're really starting to move into this autonomous age now, right? We have Google trying to build the self-driving car. Pretty soon, right, it won't be a driver picking me up at the hotel. I'll be stepping in a vehicle and hoping that it's going where I want it to go, right? So we're already starting to think about how are we going to prepare for an age where the jobs that we have no longer exist, right? Estimates say that 50% of current jobs will be done by computers and robots in another 10 to 20 years' time, right? So we have some things we have to start to think about. And then in Japan, they think of this next era as being what they call modern well-being. very sensitive about health and well-being of their aging population, and thinking about how are we going to have strong nutrition and well-being as a community when we have robots potentially being our nurses and doctors. What does that mean for us as humankind? So they're really starting to think about that. And their Minister of Education talks about the need for students to have what he calls three powers. And I'll summarize, because it's very hard to get the Japanese philosophy over, so I'm going to Americanize my version of his three powers here. He talks about computer literacy, soft skills, 21st century skills, which I think is something we see commonly, and then something we certainly don't talk about enough in the US, which is compassion and empathy. All right. So he's really talking about schools where we have to break down disciplinary barriers. We have to start thinking about the world as an interdisciplinary space, and that to be able to function in that future society, we are going to have to be able to function with computers. We're going to have to be computer literate. We're going to have to be able to problem solve, use creativity, innovation, right, as we move forward, while not losing our human aspects of compassion and empathy. All right. And so with STEM right now, we're seeing a lot moving towards this computer literacy space. Right? So that's thinking about that STEM literacy and how do we build that into what we do. All right, so back to the US. So in the United States, I feel like I have my back to you all the time. I'm going to move, so I'm not rude to you all the time. How about I go over here for a second? I'll be rude to you now and put my back to you. How about that? I'm not very good at standing still either, so let's try this side for a little bit. So we have the Next Generation Science Standards. So in 2012, the frameworks for science education were released, and in 2013, they released these new Next Generation Science Standards. And you'll hear a lot about three-dimensional learning in the United States, and that's thinking about these three aspects that we want to see in our instruction. So core disciplinary core ideas, science and engineering practices, and what we call cross-cutting concepts. So, just to give you a very quick look at what that looks like, because you'll see some of this language come up as I start to talk about what's happening in our STEM schools. This is the bit we're all very familiar with. This is the content that students are supposed to learn. So, you see physics, you see energy, you see forces and motion, you see waves, matter and its interaction. So that looks like what we would expect, right? Students are going to be learning that content. Over here, is how we want the students to learn the content. So thinking about what scientists and engineers do, so asking questions, developing and using models, planning and carry out investigations to collect data, which we then analyze and interpret. That interpretation often uses mathematical and computational thinking. And then from that data and analysis, we want students to construct explanations or design solutions if we're in a more engineering space. And we want them to be able to engage in argument from that evidence, right? We may disagree about what the best solution is. So how are we going to use evidence to marshal that and make a decision? And then how do we ultimately communicate that information? All right. So we want students to learn that content through engagement in these practices. And then the cross-cutting themes is honestly something that as you walk into any school in the US and ask any of the teachers, they'll go, yeah, we don't do those. We're not really quite sure how to do that. Okay, so you won't hear me talk a lot about those, but in essence, these are things that cut across all of the sciences. So whether I'm an engineer, whether I'm a botanist, whether I'm a physicist, these are ideas, sort of big ideas and ways of thinking that scientists engage in. So if we think about structure and function, if anyone's a biology teacher, right, we think about the parts of the cell and how their structure relates to the function that they cause in the cell. If you're a chemist, like I used to be in a former lifetime, we think about how the functionality of the different chemicals creates different reactions and behaviors, things like that. So these are there implicitly, but we don't see them very much coming out explicitly in our instruction. But the important thing to think about here, and this is how, again, in Japan they think about this, is the way we used to teach, the way I learned back in England, back in the day, was we focused here. And I am really good at memorizing stuff. I got an A in physics because I'm good at algebra, not because I understand physics, it turns out, right? So this is that traditional way of teaching. When we have Google, we don't need to memorize this anymore. I can look things up, right? What scientists and engineers do and what we need to do to forge ahead in the future and hopefully sustain our planet in the process is we need to use that knowledge to apply to novel situations. So we need to be able to create knowledge. We need to use knowledge to innovate. All right. So we still want students to learn these things, but we want them to learn how to use them and create with them. So it's a very different way of thinking about teaching and thinking about learning. So that's sort of the backdrop of what we're seeing in the United States. But we're a little unique in how we do some things. Oh, I guess I'll talk about engineering before I talk about that. So, engineering was the thing that kind of rocked everyone's world as a teacher when it came out. In Minnesota, we actually started doing engineering in 2009. And everyone said, well, I have a chemistry degree. I don't know anything about engineering. I'm an elementary teacher. I don't know anything about engineering. So this was the new thing that we had to grapple with. And really the whole idea here is, hitting the wrong button, is engineering gives us that real world context for learning, right? How many of you had your students go, "What? Why do I need to know this? I'm never going to use calculus in my life. Why do I need to learn calculus?" Right? We hear that all the time. So this notion of using a real world context for learning removes that "why do I have to know this?" Right? I have a problem to solve. I'm learning it so I can solve this problem. And then also attaching to those literacy skills, right, the 21st century skills, by engaging in engineering, we're going to develop problem-solving skills, communication skills, teamwork. Right? So it's a more authentic, real-world way to do that. And so you'll see engineering become very central in some of the work that we do, partly because it's new. And when you bring in new content, it's sometimes easier to break and disrupt those habits we have as teachers. Right? I've taught chemistry for a long time, right? I know how to do it. Don't tell me how to do it new. I've got it, right? This disrupts it, which is actually good pedagogically to start to think about things a little bit differently. So how does this work in the United States? Because we don't have a nationalized anything. We don't have a nationalized curriculum. We don't have nationalized testing. We don't have nationalized teacher preparation. So really what happens, even though the next generation science standards, people will tell you there are national standards, that means something different wherever you go. The only thing from federal law that impacts each of our states is that we have to test students at certain grade levels. So in science, all students are tested as they leave elementary school in fifth grade, middle school in eighth grade, and then they're usually tested in their biology knowledge at some point during their high school. That test data is used to assess schools. It is not used to assess students. It doesn't help them get into college. So there's some really kind of strange processes in there. But so if we think about the next generation science standards, which is what supposedly guides STEM in our country, the states in blue have completely adopted NGSS. So if you were to look at that document, you've got a good idea what's happening in those classrooms if you walk in. States in orange have sort of kind of adopted it. They've adopted bits of it, but not all of it. They've changed the language a little bit to sort of suit some particular issue in their states. And then these states in this sort of light blue gray color have not yet adopted it. Some of them will never adopt it. Texas will never adopt it for political reasons. Florida, probably the same way. If you remember Minnesota up there, we're about to turn yellow. We just adopted new standards that are in the process of lawmaking right now, and they are very much guided by the NGSS, and so we will turn yellow on that map, all right? But yellow means something different in every place, right? So it's really hard to know what national standards mean, but what I can tell you is the essence of them do guide what we do. And in Minnesota, we actually started doing a lot of this work in 2009. So we're one of the states, along with Massachusetts, which are over here somewhere. That's Washington, D.C., so I don't know. Massachusetts is in this. It's one of those little blue states over there. They were with Massachusetts, we were one of the early adopters of STEM. So in many ways, what we're doing is a little more cutting edge than NGSS. So as we do that, what we start to see is a whole bunch of different enactments of what we'll loosely call STEM, right? If you Google STEM, you'll see 1,000 different definitions. You'll see every different kind of setup of an acronym. We all have our little cute logos and things like that, right? But you walk into a school, you'll see something different every single time, right? Teachers have different conceptions and ideas about STEM. We also see STEAM coming up a lot, and I know at AUC STEAM is very much what is happening here. And in many ways, the argument here is that by adding the arts, you're adding some more elements of design and creativity involved in that. I would say engineers don't thrive if they're not creative, so I think it's interesting that we bring in the arts to supposedly generate creativity. It causes, when we don't think about what we mean by the A, it can cause some interest in strange implementations. I think the value to me here is of thinking about the impact on society and the social sciences and how that comes in, right? But moving, this is nebulous, this becomes more nebulous, right? What does this mean now? I'm integrating A. You'll also see in the United States, sometimes the A means agriculture. So just for fun, if you go to a STEAM school, it might not even mean what you think it means. And then we're starting to see a lot of what are becoming C-STEM schools and add in that computer focus, right? These are logos that schools use to attract students, right? Even in our public schools, students are able to cross boundaries and go to different schools, right? You may not receive free busing, but if a parent is savvy and wealthy enough, they can move their kids 20 miles to go to school every day to get into that STEM school. If you get more students in your school, you get more funding from the government. So it's become very much a way to attract students, and so these logos mean different things for different people, and sometimes people are moving their kids for good reasons and sometimes not, as we'll see. So Minnesota kind of does NGSS. In Minnesota, like many states, each school makes its own decisions. We have no national curriculum. We don't have a state curriculum, right? So if you go into Mohammed's school, or I go into your school, you'll see biology class, you'll see chemistry class, you'll see things you expect, but they'll look completely different. They use different textbooks, they do different experiments. Everything is different, even within a school. You might be the chemistry teachers in my school. You may not all be doing the same thing, right? So for each student, I might get this, I might get that group work, innovative, STEM, project-based learning in my classroom, or I might get traditional learning. It's kind of random, right? It's just luck of the draw what you get, right? And that's a problem, right? That's frustrating for students, it's frustrating for parents. How do you navigate that system? Because what we really want is everyone to have this experience, right? So how do we go about doing that? And STEM schools is maybe part of that answer, all right? So the idea with STEM schools, from our perspective, is to try and guarantee a more systematic implementation of these kinds of reforms, right? How do we know when we send our child to that school that they're going to truly get STEM, right? And they're going to have those experiences that are going to help propel them and be more successful in the future, all right? So here's a quote from President Obama, my favorite president, saying that the federal government should promote the creation of at least 200 new highly STEM-focused high schools and 800 STEM-focused elementary and middle schools over the next decade. So this was in 2010, right? That decade has now happened. And he goes on to say, including and serving minority and high-poverty communities, right? So we don't just want STEM schools for the affluent, right? We want to make sure that this is an equitable thing that we have. You probably got the idea from me talking about NGSS and how it's sort of random, how it's implemented. This, even though it's coming from the federal government doesn't provide money to do these things. They're just sort of suggesting that we might want to do this, okay? Many people have taken them up on it, but it's not funded by the government. There are no guidelines, there are no policies. And so ultimately what happens is anyone can label themselves a STEM school. There's no rules. It's the wild, wild west, okay? And I grabbed this off of the internet, so I do not want anyone to go thinking that Dayton Regional School is there's a problem with it at all. It's just an image I pulled off the internet, right? But you will see STEM on many schools. You could walk in that school, and Mohammed's had this experience and going very quietly into my office and saying, Jill, I don't think there's any STEM happening in that school, right? And he was right, right? It's there's no rules, right? You can just go paint that on your school and move on. So it's a problem. So as we started saying, okay, if we want to start some STEM schools, and we kind of got into this business, I wasn't personally starting the schools, but we were helping to support some of those initiatives, what do we know about STEM schools, right? So starting to sort of dig into that research literature and try and find out who's doing STEM, who's doing it well, and how can we help these schools do that? We found three different kinds of schools out there. The selective high schools are the way I think they work here in Egypt, right? There's some sort of entrance admission. The top students are going, right? You're going to look at some kind of assessment and say, you're high enough, you're high enough, you're high enough. Sorry, you didn't make the cut, right? Okay, very simple, right? And those exist, and they exist for good reasons, right? The STEM-focused technical and career-ready schools are a little bit more like our two-year colleges. They're really preparing people for the more those technical professional degrees, so more like an electrician, a plumber, a lab technician, those kinds of things. They're more on that side of things, which we definitely need. I start to question what that might look like, right, with robotics and 50% of those jobs disappearing. But that's really focused on a more career and technical education kind of space. And so what we were interested in is this inclusive STEM high school. This is saying the school in my neighborhood, the public school, is going to become a STEM school, right? All of you are coming to a STEM school. You don't have to apply. You don't have to take an exam. Your parents don't have to pay a big tuition check. We're going to make this readily accessible to everybody. Because if we want to get more people in STEM, we want to increase diversity, we have to do it that way. All right? So that's what we became interested in. And before we go on, I'm surprised someone's probably twitching, right? Like begging to ask the question, what do you mean by STEM, right? It means lots of different things. And I'm going to give you a very loose definition, and I'm keeping the definition loose on purpose because the more you try and lock it down, the more people are like, well, that only works if I'm a science teacher. Or oh, that might work if I'm a math teacher, right? It starts to get a little bit tricky when we start to think about a STEM school. So really when I'm talking about STEM and we work with the schools, we're talking that students are engaged in developing solutions to real world problems, right? So it's problem-based learning at its heart, all right? That doesn't mean they're doing problem-based learning all the time, but as much as we can, we're trying to implement that. They're engaged in STEM practices. So they're engaged in the authentic work of being a scientist or an engineer in those spaces, and we can't call it STEM if there's not content from at least two of the STEM disciplines, right? It's awesome if we have inquiry-based science. I'm not saying that we shouldn't do that, but there's got to be some integration, some merging of that content for us to start to call it STEM, all right? And often, and I don't want to exclude non-STEM disciplines, often it includes those other disciplines as well, all right? So I'm not saying it can only be science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Because we really want to include all of the teachers, not just the science and math teachers. So at the time we started this work, this is really all we could find out in the research literature about what makes a STEM school a STEM school. And so I'll share just, and I'll use this as we go through and evaluate our STEM schools and think about those experiences and what worked and what didn't in those STEM schools. What I will tell you as we look at this, so this is work by Erin Peters-Burton and Sharon Lynch. If anyone's interested, I can provide those citations for you. They've done some really excellent work in this area. This is focused on high schools. Erin Peters-Burton has since done some work on elementary schools, so she has a parallel set of components for elementary schools, if any of you are elementary background and interested in that. So what her and her team did is they visited exemplary existing STEM high schools. Some of these have been in existence for up to 20 years. For example, High Tech High in San Diego, where I used to work, is one of the schools that she visited. And they spent a lot of time with those schools, interviewing the community, interviewing teachers, interviewing principals. They observed in the school to see what was happening and said, what are the characteristics that make these schools successful as inclusive STEM schools? Right? And they looked across enough cases to say with some certainty, these are the things that make this work. All right. So they'll be interesting to think about if you're at a school that's a STEM school or you're doing some STEM programming. How do these right? Does my school do these things, and to what degree do they do them? All right. Certainly not saying if you don't do all of them, you're not a good STEM school. Right. This is just the data they found in the U.S. It has to be STEM-focused curriculum. Teachers have to be using reform instructional strategies. There has to be innovative technology use. There's some blending of out-of-school and in-school experiences. So there are strong after-school community STEM spaces, maybe internships with companies. Students are doing work in the community, so it's not just about the classroom. The schools have partnerships with businesses, industry, community. Right? It's not just about the school. It's a broader space. Because we're talking about high schools, there is a lot of early college-level coursework. Some students are actually taking college-level courses and getting credits before they go into college. As a parent, that's awesome. My daughter graduated in 3 years instead of 4 years because she got that early-level coursework. That saved me a whole year of tuition, which is awesome. I'll not tell you how awesome that is. It means we've got to think about our teaching staff, right? They've got to be well-prepared. They've got to have the right professional development to do the job we're asking them to do. The mission had better actually be inclusive, right? Am I really welcoming all students, or is there some sort of secret back door that I can exclude people. 9 and 12 we'll talk about quite a bit as we give examples. They're both about leadership, school leadership, right? Having the right principals, the right superintendents, the right support from, in your case, it would be the Ministry of Education. For us, it's often our state Board of Education, right? That leadership has to be in place. If we're going to welcome all students, we need to make sure that we have the right support for those students. Right? So if I tell all of you now you're going to be in a STEM school, maybe some of you need a little bit of extra help with math. Maybe some of you need a little bit of extra help with writing, right? That we still have to provide those academic supports for students. We have to think really hard about assessment systems, right? Our existing assessment systems are not going to work well in a STEM space. We need positive school community and a culture of high expectation. And students still have to have agency and choice. I haven't given any of you a choice. I've said it's an inclusive STEM school. You're all coming. It's your neighborhood school, right? But outside of that, you still have to have some choice in how you engage, right? Maybe it's choice with projects, choices with classes, things like that, okay? So we'll touch on these as we go throughout, and I'm going to tell you sort of the journey and the development of some of our local schools in this regard. So we'll come back and do some more detail on some of these things, okay? So what we were really interested in, which wasn't anywhere in the literature, and we could not find any help on doing this, is how do you start a STEM school? Right? We had districts who were saying, the most common phone call we were getting around 2009 when the new standards came out, we want to become a STEM school. Could you tell us how to become a STEM school? At which point we're like, no, not really. But that's the journey we embarked on. So how do you start and get to that point where you might have been one of those exemplary schools in that study, right? I've got 14 things here, right? If Mohammed wants to start a new school, where does he start? All 14 at the same time, right? Or are some of them more important than others, right? These were questions we had, right? So as we watched these schools and worked with them, we started to try and unpack that. How do we do that? What does it mean to become a teacher in that school? What does it mean to open this school? And so I'm going to tell you the tale of two districts. And what you'll start to learn is one district is doing really well and is successful, and one less so. And maybe we can learn something from that process. So this is a sort of mid-sized rural school district. It's in southern Minnesota. I will keep telling you the proper name because they're very proud of what they do. It's Owatonna School District. If you ever visit Minnesota and people come a lot to say they want to learn about STEM, that is where I take people, okay? And there's about 5,000 to 6,000 students in that school. They have four elementary schools, McKinley, Washington, Wilson, and Lincoln, all presidents. They have one middle school and one high school, okay? So it's not a large school system, all right, but that's their school. And they are about 75% white kids and about 25% who are students of color. And those students of color are many, many immigrant students. So if you were to walk in those schools, you would see many Somali students. You would see many ladies wearing the hijab. There is a large Muslim population there with those immigrant students. Also a lot of immigrant students who are Hmong, coming from some of the countries in East Asia. Over here, we have a very large urban school district. There are 68 schools in this district. They serve like almost 200,000 students. It's very large. There's like 45 elementary schools and then large number of middle and high schools. For their story, I'm going to focus just on four of their middle schools and one of their high schools, because those are the schools that engaged with us in the project towards becoming STEM. All right. So here I'm going to talk about the whole district because all of the schools are involved in the project. And here I'm going to talk about five out of those 68 schools, all right? These ones are pseudonyms, as you'll see, for a variety of reasons. Some of those schools would rather not have me tell you who they really are. All right, so let's dig into some of those critical components, all right? I'm gonna move sides. I've got a crick in my neck on this side. All right, okay. So, inclusive STEM mission seems easy, right? I'm going to take my existing public school, I'm going to become STEM, I'm inclusive because everyone comes to that school anyway, right? Seems simple. Turns out it's not that simple, and this is where critical component 11 really starts to play out, which was flexible autonomous leadership. That to me, when I first heard that, I'm like, what do you mean flexible autonomous leadership? So I've tried to unpack that a little bit for you. So the organizational structure of the school is mission driven. They're purposefully becoming STEM, STEM is their mission, and everything they do is focused on that mission. Which means that the school leaders need to have a well-defined strategy for STEM instruction, and it needs to be implemented with some level of fidelity, right? I can't have this set of teachers deciding to do STEM and the rest of you just going about business of normal as normal, right? There has to be some kind of systematic process in there. These schools probably have partnerships with other networks, businesses, nonprofit organizations, and they're working with the school both to develop those shared goals, but also you'll see it's pretty important to leverage that expertise, leadership, and resources to the school. When we can get engineers involved in thinking about this, when we can get companies involved, that really helps bring that real-world, authentic piece into the school. And that administrative structure has to have external awareness to the community outside of the school. Right? So they're constantly thinking about what does the community need, how do we work within that community, and how do we leverage that mission and make sure that we're true to our mission. So I'll tell you a little bit about Owatonna here. Owatonna starts with a kind of strange story. It's a very typical U.S. story at about this time. They became a STEM school in 2012. At that time, a policy called No Child Left Behind from our junior President Bush was really in full effect. And that meant that schools who were not doing well on their standardized testing could be closed and taken over by the state. And McKinley was in danger of that. Their test scores were really low. They were not thriving as a school. And they had to do something. They worked very closely with the community and talking about what that would be, and they decided to become a STEM school. And so they started that work, and one of the best things that they did at that point is they were serious about doing it, and they hired a STEM coordinator to help lead that work. So they had someone who was a dedicated administrator in the school whose only job was to help them develop and become STEM. A year later, they started with the middle school. Middle schools are larger. They're a little more complex in their structure, and so they wanted to sort of have a phased-in process. So they started with the sixth grade and said, let's start there, right, and then add seventh grade, add eighth grade as we go, and sort of take a phased-in process. And there you'll see I'm calling them an E-STEM school. E is environmental. So you see a very heavy environmental focus in those schools. They're a rural area, very interested in agriculture. There's a lot of natural rivers, streams, lakes, those kinds of things there. So it contextually made sense for them to do that. This project at McKinley and the middle school was incredibly successful. It took a lot of work with the teachers around curriculum development and professional development that I'll tell you more in the next slides about how they went about that work. But it was so successful that after about 4 years, McKinley went from being a failing school that the state was going to take over to being the top performing school in their district. They were all of a sudden doing better than Washington, Wilson, and Lincoln. And now parents are going, huh, what's going on? And some of them started to send their children to McKinley instead. McKinley ran out of room. They couldn't take any more parents. So now you have angry parents calling the office, why can't my child get into McKinley? At which point they said, okay, maybe we should have more STEM schools. And so they worked with the principals and agreed on a phase-in process. So Washington opened as a STEM school in 2018, with Wilson and Lincoln just starting this year. So they're in their first year right now of becoming STEM schools. And this is a push from the community now, right? This isn't the principal going, I want to be a STEM school too. This is parents. This is the community pushing that effort. And the high school has been resisting and resisting and resisting. For us, high schools are the hardest to get to change. They're very siloed, right? Teachers have strong identities. If I were asked each of you, you'd probably start with, I teach chemistry. I'm a physics teacher, right? We identify with our content, and we love our content, right? That's how we think, right? And we're in those silos. It's harder to break the mold with high school teachers. I was one, so I hope I'm not offending anyone by saying that. It would have been a little tricky to get me to shift at the time as well. But what we've seen there is that push from these middle school students to get into ninth grade and going, this isn't how you teach. This isn't how this works. Where's our projects, right? But why are we doing this test? We don't, right? They're starting to push. Parents are starting to push. And the high school is going to start in 2021. By having a sort of STEM academy within the school, so some STEM pathways, right? So you've got a lot of push from the community, you've got a leadership who's very flexible, and developing a process to do this, right? And it is a process. These schools wanted to become STEM earlier than they did, and that was done purposefully and thoughtfully to make sure that the resources and the training were all in place to do that. All right, let's take a look at this school district over here. Some different things going on. So we started working with these schools with a project from the Cargill Foundation in 2016. And that was a project Mohammed did some work on with his dissertation. And so three of these schools, Falconer, Nodak, and Somerville, were picked by the two STEM coordinators in the district. They had some friends there who were teachers. They thought they were good teachers. And they said, yeah, these are strong teachers. They can lead the STEM effort. So they were picked by the district, but it was sort of a grassroots kind of thing, right? These are teachers who want to do STEM. We're going to let the teachers do it. And the principals just sort of nodded and agreed and said, sure, the University of Minnesota can come in and do whatever it is they're going to do. The principals weren't against it, but they really didn't know what we were doing or, you know, weren't necessarily actively supporting that. Falconer was a school decision to become STEM. No one in the district knew that they were going to become STEM until all of a sudden they advertised for a STEM teacher, at which point everyone was like, what? When did that happen? That was the principal making a decision to say, we want to be STEM, we want to get more students into our school. So we said, okay, if you're going to do it, welcome on board. And then NOTHA was a little different from this group, but we chose to work with them. They were a high school, similar story to McKinley, actually. They'd actually closed as a high school. It was a school that was had a lot of problems, and they reopened. So they took 2 years as a community to re-envision what their school was going to look like. And STEM was part of that school. So when they reopened, the STEM Academy was some of the students in the high school, and then there was another academy that was a performing arts academy. So students were coming here purposefully with certain missions involved. And so we worked with the STEM Academy part of the larger high school there. Very purposeful, thoughtful. They spent 2 years thinking about that decision. They hired staff purposefully knowing they were reopening as a STEM school. So the staff were interviewed knowing that they were going to be STEM teachers. And the principal in charge was actually a former science teacher. So there was a strong leadership as well in that regard. All right, so let's take a look at some of these other ones. Real world STEM partnerships. Let's think about that, because that's where the money is, right? We need money to do these things, right? It doesn't come for cheap. And if it's a public school becoming a STEM school, they've just got the normal funding any other school has. There's no extra money for becoming STEM, right? So they've got to figure out how they're going to do this. And so Owatonna worked with local businesses and foundations. Their STEM coordinator, Tom, was very successful in writing grants. He spent a lot of time knocking on doors, bragging about what the school did, getting people interested. And he's happy to take $100 from you, $1,000 from you, $10,000. He will just collect donations and get things going. That money went into some infrastructure things. So they have some maker spaces. They were able to get some equipment with that and build some of that up over time. Most of the money, however, went here, teachers' professional development. He made a really big pitch to the businesses that if we're going to do this right, it's not about stuff. I can put fancy microscopes in people's classrooms, but the teachers need to know how to use them, and they need to know how to teach in a STEM way. And so all of the professional development work that the teachers did, and all of the teachers have over time taken a STEM certificate at some different institutions around southern Minnesota, which is a 12 to 16 graduate credit certificate program. All of that tuition paid for by local businesses. This didn't cost the teachers any money, and they were given all of the support for driving to those classes, things like that, to do it. They're eSTEM, as I told you. They got work to have a school garden. And so at the middle school, they have a garden where they do a lot of different projects around agricultural things and ecology. They have a lot of elective courses. One of them is a forensics course. And the teachers who did this were had asked some of the local police to come and talk with the kids about some of the detective work. And the police actually invited them. And these two ladies went to detective school one summer. And they actually learned how to process crime scene along with the professionals. They didn't charge them to do this. The police welcomed them in. And they went through this whole process so they would be more familiar and have a more authentic experience here. So you can see the community is involved in different ways. Some of it's money. Some of it's just offering a service, right? And then if we look over here, the Cargill Foundation was involved in this project. They're a very large company. They make a lot of, they do a lot of stuff with agriculture, seeds, fertilizer, pesticides, things like that. A very, very large company. And the district used the money to hire two district STEM coordinators. So they put pretty much all of the money into people, okay? And when the money went, guess what happens? They went too, right? So it's a temporary fix. It's a way of like putting some people in place. But as soon as that grant disappeared, those people are gone, right? Whereas in this school, the STEM coordinator is paid by the school part of their budget, okay? NOTHA has systematically worked over time also to get grants, get local companies involved. They've done it a little differently. Some of it has been money to create like a makerspace. It's not quite a fab lab that I think you have in some of your STEM schools, but it's sort of working towards that kind of fab lab kind of space. But the main thing they do being a high school is they want partnerships for their students to have mentors and internships. So one of the things that they wanted to have is by the time their students were in their last 2 years of high school, they would spend part of their day working in companies. They wanted to have that authentic experience where they would actually go and work as an engineer or whatever it might be. And so what they've really leveraged is that space for their students to have those experiences, to be able to do real world projects with real businesses. Okay, so it's a slightly different way of leveraging, but it makes sense in a high school space to do it that way. Okay. So we're seeing some strong leveraging, and then some leveraging that didn't pan out in the end. Okay. All right. Curriculum and teacher professional development. Without those, you're not going to have a well-prepared STEM teaching staff, right? Hopefully at some point, we will get to the point where all of the teachers we're hiring have gone through some kind of STEM training, right? So if we're hiring teachers from AUC, they're ready to do STEM, right? Okay. But we've got a lot of teachers who are already in the schools who haven't heard of STEM. So right now we're at a point where we have to do that kind of work. And so in Owatonna, they spent a lot of time on curriculum development, most of it locally developed and very little commercially bought curriculum. And I'll talk about that a little bit later because some of that commercial curriculum is just frankly not good. And teachers learn a lot by developing curriculum. Teacher professional development was done by all schools being involved. That's why they phased out in the elementary schools over time, is because it wasn't just you two from this school, you two from this school. The whole school is engaged in that professional development. I mean the whole school. I ran for the two schools that just came on, Wilson and Lincoln. We had over 70 people doing a one-week professional development with me last summer. The principal stayed for the whole week. The librarians were there. The nurse was there, right? I really do mean the whole school is understanding what it means to be STEM and engaged in that learning. They have the STEM certificate program I talked about, so it's not just one shot. It's not just Jill comes in for 1 week and does something and then, you know, everything's magically fixed. They have ongoing over 2 years working on this STEM certificate. They have team planning time. They have time structured into their day when they can meet and plan these different projects that cut across the different classes, right? So it might be at the elementary, it's probably by grade level, right? The third grade team meets, the fifth grade team meets. At the middle school, it's in a team at the social science teacher, the science teacher, the math teacher, the language arts teacher. They're working collaboratively together on that planning, right? To be able to look at interdisciplinary, cross-disciplinary projects. And they have strong coaching support. So Tom, who's the STEM coordinator, has moved his office more times than I even know. I never know where to find him. I just call him to find out where he is. But he's worked through those schools as they've come on board and spent a lot of time with the teachers in their classroom coaching them and helping them to get feedback on their instruction. Sometimes he might say, you know what, Heba, let me teach the class, right? And so that gives her a chance to see him do STEM and go, oh, that's what you want me to do, right? That's what it looks like, co-teaching with the teachers. So it's a lot of time. It's not just an institute in the summer. It's ongoing summer institutes and ongoing work throughout the school year. What we see over in the other district is a focus on commercial curriculum. Being a large district, they have this sense of wanting uniformity, right? So all the STEM schools should have similar experiences, which means we're all going to buy the same curriculum. So there's a far bigger focus on commercial products there. They do their teacher professional development just science teachers and individual teachers at a time. So they do great professional development, by the way. I'm not at all slamming what they do. In fact, both of their STEM coordinators, when those positions were done, came to work with me and on their PhDs. They're awesome people. They do amazing stuff, right? But their mandate was to work with certain teachers, just science teachers. They weren't allowed to work with any other teachers. And they would just pick the teachers who were interested. So you get random acts of STEM, right, across the district instead of this old school focus. Both sets were focused on equity, right? There's a lot of diversity in these schools. They were thinking about gender. They were thinking about how to get people engaged. So that was common. The only school over here that had any sense of team planning time was NOTA, which was the STEM Academy in the high school. These teachers had no extra planning time. They had no cross-grade level planning time. They had no coaching support. So they were pretty much left to kind of figure out what STEM by themselves and how do I use this strange curriculum that you bought me. Okay. All right. Positive school climate. Seems like kind of an obvious one, right? We want all our schools to have a positive climate. But it means something a little different than what most people think of when they hear that. So it is a school environment where people feel safe, right? We don't want to see bullying, harassment, those kinds of things. It's a space where students learn that it's okay to make mistakes. They're encouraged to take risks, right? We talk about a growth mindset with our students, right? If you're going to really do STEM, it doesn't work all the time, right? My brother's an engineer for Rolls-Royce. He designs airplane engines. His job is actually to break things. His job is to like figure out all the different ways things can break and then try and make it not happen, right? Failure is his life, right? That's what he's supposed to do, right? And we want the students to have that experience. Because if you're going to innovate, right, 90% of your ideas don't pan out, right? You just got to keep going until you get the one that does. But that's also true for teachers. So we have to encourage the teachers to collaborate and take risks in their instruction as well. This isn't just about students feeling safe and having an intellectually free environment. It's also about the teachers as well, which is really important as we start to think about the work that's happening in these STEM schools. So what we see when we have that positive school environment, we're supporting teachers to take risks, right, and collaborate and work together to come up with new kinds of instruction, is what we see is really low teacher and principal turnover. The principals have been there the whole time. We haven't seen a single principal leave. There's an odd teacher who leaves, retires, right, things happen. But we're just seeing that the teachers are staying in those schools. They want to be in those schools. That established STEM coordinator, I can't tell you enough times how important that role is, right? It is one person whose whole job is to help STEM happen, right? And Mohammed, you could call him and say, hey, I'm trying to do this thing next week. I need more test tubes. I don't know how Tom does it, but magically test tubes will appear in your classroom, right? Whatever they need, they get it. They've really focused on developing teacher leaders. This was one of the biggest frustrations as more schools came on board is the teachers will keep saying, we miss Tom. Tom used to be in our building. Tom's not there anymore, right? This guy was like critical. And so they really worked on getting those teacher leaders in schools so they didn't have to keep calling Tom all the time. There were a series of teachers who'd become experts in STEM who were starting to lead professional development themselves, right? So they were becoming self-supporting in some of that work. They really focused on community building, both amongst the teachers, with the students, between the parents and the community being invited in. It's very much about community and in which way you want to think about that. And then I didn't talk much about agency and choice, but I want to talk how that played out just a little bit in the middle school. STEM isn't really necessarily for all students, and some kinds of STEM aren't that exciting, right? I personally could care less how fast an airplane goes, if a rocket gets to Mars, how fast, what the world land speed record for some car is. I'm not interested. My brothers love it, right? They're both engineers. That's what they do, right? Me. I'm not an engineer because I'm not interested in that. Turns out, not all engineering is like that, right? And so as we start to think about choices, there's different ways we can think about environmental engineering. We can think about biomedical engineering, right? So giving students these different choices that they have now elective courses where they can choose to take more STEM in these unique ways. Forensics is one example of one of the STEM electives. What it also did, as well as giving students agency and choice, is it gave teachers this world to explore in. Right? We all are passionate about something, and they were able to bring their passion and develop their own classes. Right? They might have one section with 25 students, but it was something they really cared about and they were excited about. And it allowed the teachers as well to really get excited about some of the things that they were doing, which was pretty cool to watch. Okay. Over into my big urban school district over here. We had crazy teacher and principal turnover. I lost track. One school was a new principal every year. I couldn't even keep track of who I was emailing to ask permission to do things. We had teachers quitting in our school year starts at the beginning of September. At the end of October, teachers were quitting, right? One school. How many teachers left Faulkner? I don't even know, right? Like five or six. It was crazy. In the middle of the year, they would just not turn up. It was absolutely crazy. We saw decreased district support. Well, we had the two STEM coordinators in place. Things were going kind of okay, right? But when that funding ran out and they were gone, now nobody knew who to turn to anymore. All of that commercially bought equipment that was centrally located, nobody knew how to get to it, right? So things started to fall apart. Most of the schools have a single STEM elective, right? That's all they had, if they could get the teacher to do it. And because the principals weren't on board with this, right, they said, sure, University of Minnesota, come on in, do your thing. But they had other initiatives they were working on. There might be a literacy initiative in the school, things like that. So the teachers were constantly wondering, like, am I supposed to do STEM or am I supposed to do this? Right, because they don't fit together. I'm being asked to do these things that don't work. And it was very frustrating for the teachers. NOTHA, again, being the different sort of spotlight here, they have an established STEM coordinator. She's still there 4 years later, still working directly with the teachers, did a lot of work on community building, a lot of that individualized professional development support. So with that in place, they're still going pretty strong. So. All right, innovative and responsive leadership, right? So going back to thinking about these principals again, right? Who are these leaders in the school, right? If you're like me, you kind of liked your principal, but not really, right? They're like always telling me what to do. They come in my classroom, they evaluate me, right? They judge me, right? And it's sort of a love-hate relationship, right? But if we have innovative and responsive leadership, that's a different kind of thing. And so this is leadership that's proactive and continually addressing the needs of students, right? Constantly sort of monitoring what's going on, figuring ways to make things better. The leadership is also distributed. It doesn't all run through the principal. I don't have to go run to the principal every time I need to do something. Teachers now are part of that process. Right, these schools have different committees and different things that teachers have active voice in decision making. So the teachers are professionalized and they have some level of autonomy over what's going on. Right, even if it's just your own elective course, different things that make you feel like a professional and not just someone who's supposed to turn up and do what you're told to do. And it's constantly shifting. Right, even once you've established a STEM school, things change. Right. You lose a business partner, something happens, you have a new teacher who comes on board, right? You're constantly responding to change and you have a process to do that. So, I'll do this sort of, so where are they now? How's that responsive thing worked out? You've kind of got a good sense here where this is going, right? Right? I haven't told you anything here that's gonna suggest bad things are happening in Owatonna. A few changes have happened. McKinley has shifted from STEM to STEAM. They did this purposefully. For all the reasons I've heard here, people talk about STEAM. There is something about adding the arts and the social sciences that enhances what the students are learning, right? They're thinking more about communication and 21st century skills. They're thinking more about the societal relevance of what they're doing, right? Just because you can engineer something doesn't mean you should. You have to think about the consequences of it and how it impacts different people and communities. So that has added a whole new focus for them that's really enriched the learning that they're doing, and that's purposeful. Washington, Wilson, and Lincoln, you know, been going year two, year one. They're just moving, right? That they're in that professional development process. The teachers are in the STEM certificate, so hard to know where they're going, but they're starting that process. The middle school is fully eSTEM now. Right, they've got all the teachers trained, they have their electives in place, they have their processes in place, right? But they're continually working with the community and thinking about how well that's working. And then the new high school that's going to be opening. The way school funding works in the United States is delightfully weird, as are many things. I've lived there for longer than I lived in England now, but I still don't understand my new country sometimes. If you want to get a new school, you have to get the people in the community to vote to pay more taxes to do it. And it won't surprise you to know lots of people don't want to pay more taxes. And so often when schools have these referendums, people say no. Nope, nope, no more money for schools, no more money for schools. I don't have kids, why would I pay more money for schools, right? They've been so successful with their community partnerships that they got the money to have a brand new high school building. And with that new building, they're now able to create some of those spaces. They'll have a fab lab, those kinds of things. And so they'll be developing a STEM pathway as part of that. But that's how embedded they are in the community and how supportive the community are. Over here, not so good. Liberty, Nodak, and Somerville. They quit pretty much before the 3 years were up that we were working with them. Liberty dropped out after the first year. The principal was like, nope, we're not doing this. We have a new mission. And I forget what it was, couldn't even tell you now, but the only remnant of STEM left now is that they have a makerspace and there's a teacher who has a makerspace elective class. That's the only remnant of STEM that's left. NODAC did quite well. There were a lot of wonderful acts of STEM in the school, but as those teachers left, STEM left with them, because there was no support and infrastructure there. So as the teachers who were doing STEM left, that was it. It sort of it died a slow death as those people left. Somerville pretty much quit after the first year. They had a shift in principal. The teacher who was leading the STEM initiative, I'm still not quite sure what he got mad about, but he quit halfway through the second year and just left. He left teaching altogether, and that was the end of that. Faulkner still call themselves a STEM school. They have one STEM elective class, that's it, right? So they've become one of those schools that it says STEM on the door, but it's really not STEM, nothing going on. Nova, who I've sort of touched in periodically there as a highlight within this school, they are fully STEM now. They started just at 9th grade, added 10th grade, added 11th grade, added 12th grade, so they did it slowly and systematically in terms of that process. They now have all grades. And in spite of some shifts, a new principal coming in, they've been able to maintain that. It's a small school of about 100 students per grade level, but they've been able to maintain that. They've got those internships for all of their students, and they're very proud of the work that they're doing. So they'd obviously set up a system that was working well for them. So let's go back to here. And I have no idea, Heber, how long have I been yapping away? Am I an hour? I'll speed it up, because I've been talking for too long. So, all right, so this is where we started. Those are the ones I'm going to tell you are the most important as you get started. I'm not saying the others are not important. I'm just going to tell you those are the most important ones when you get started. You've got to have the administration on board, and they've got to be the kind of leadership who are going to move, support the teachers, allow failure to happen, and support the teachers when it does, right, to get those improvements. You've got to focus on curriculum, pedagogy, otherwise your teachers aren't going to be ready to do this. And if your teachers can't do this, it ain't going to happen, right? So this is where the focus has to be, right? For at least the first 2 years, right, as the teachers are getting comfortable with doing that. And it doesn't mean after 2 years you're done, right? But then you're more doing supportive things than getting the initiative going. I won't say too much, because I've been talking for way too long. But that prepackaged curriculum you can find, some of it's okay, and most of it is just absolute junk. So you have to be really careful. Some of it is just like craft projects. There's not really good connections to concepts. Some of it doesn't make sense in the local community. Right? There's some great curriculum out there on marine biology. Minnesota is like 1,000 miles from an ocean. Who cares about marine biology, right? Schools think it doesn't require professional development. Here, I'll just give it to you, you can use it. Doesn't work like that. It still requires a lot of support. There's a lot of costs. Things like Project Lead the Way are incredibly expensive to maintain. And there is a lot of male-oriented topics out there. There is a ton of curriculum on cars, bridges, airplanes. Not that that's not good and you shouldn't do it, but if that's all you have, guess what? Those girls in your classroom are not going to be that interested, right? So here's some of the things that we know about good curriculum. Engaging context. Students have to be involved in the design process. They have to be learning from failure and having opportunities to redesign. It better connect to our content, because even if we're going to become a STEM school, we still are obligated that students learn mathematics, they learn science, so there better be some content in there. It's got to be student-centered, and it's got to promote 21st century schools. That's a lot of asks for a curriculum to have. All right. So you may be able to take canned curriculum and modify it to do those things. But this is some work from one of my former students, Mohammed knows really well, Felicia Lamukda. They've published some papers together. This is that standard STEM stuff, right, that I've been talking about. If we want to make this work in an inclusive setting, and this is work she actually did at Faulkner, we've got to think about the cultural relevance, the community wealth, and the inclusiveness of that curriculum. It's got to mean something to these kids. And the work that she did really focused on issues in their community and how they could impact change in their community. This is how you get kids engaged. It's not some sort of hypothetical thing. It's real. It's their community. I'll just touch on one of them instead of all of them. Midwest Metal is a local company. It's not the real name of the company. But they'd been put out of business by a judge. Because of the high level of pollution in the community. And so the students were very engaged in that debate. Like was it a good thing they were closing? Was it a bad thing? People are losing their jobs, right? So it's not a clear-cut thing. But they'd also explored the impact of this pollution on the community. There were high amounts of lead. some of these students had brothers and sisters who got lead poisoning, which leads to all sorts of cognitive impairments. So this was a really big issue in the community, and the students were engaged in getting out in the community. They were collecting soil samples from their own backyards and understanding the spread of that pollution and really engaging in that debate as to when should a company be shut down, right? How do we do these kinds of things? It's a social issue. It's not just a science issue. All right, I'll skip over those two. Here's one of the things that we found, and this has been working a lot with Japan, but also with some of our eSTEM schools, is the Sustainable Development Goals from the United Nations are an amazing context for developing STEM curriculum. I know some of you presented at the STEAM Showcase last night, and I saw several on climate change and some of the, here we go, here, right? These are huge global issues, right, that we face in the world and in our local communities. These are great spaces to start to think about these kinds of large STEM projects. And unfortunately, in my country, it's like the United Nations doesn't exist. When we put these in front of teachers and principals, they're like, the what? The SDGs? What are those? I've never heard of that. So it's a big aha for us, maybe less so for countries who are a little more informed. The other thing we've started to do with teachers and the curriculum work we do is some small shifts in the engineering design process. It's a small shift, but we've added empathize, right? It's no longer define a problem, go through an iterative design process, and then implement your solution, but we have to empathize. We have to think about who we're designing for, what are the consequences of what we're designing, right? Someone wins and someone loses in most decisions that we make in society, and we need to really think about that and balance those issues out. So that's been a large part of how we've been able to engage more students in STEM and also bring in the non-science and math teachers there, right? That's where the social sciences really come to the fore. All right, some of these I haven't talked about, not because they're not important, because they're less important when you start a STEM school. Is why I haven't talked about them. They're things you would start to worry about 3, 4, 5 years in. You're not going to know how to support your underrepresented students until you've learned what your skills your students have. That takes time to learn and figure out how you're going to do that. It's part of that dynamic assessment process that you have to do. If you just start with building out-of-school experiences, then you're not going to have a STEM school, right? Those get built over time and over students' interests. Technology is a tricky one, and I won't spend a lot of time on this slide. There are many ways we think about technology. We're doing some work right now on what's the T in STEM. It's the most nebulous part of it. We could debate for the next hour whether technology is even a discipline, and is it equivalent to science, engineering, and mathematics. It could be the product of engineering, could be a tool, could be a learning technology, could be an iPad I put in the student's hand. It could be computational thinking. It's really a nebulous thing. And it takes time for schools to think about how are we going to use technology, right? What's that going to mean for us in our school? It's not a great place to start, right? Starting with iPads is not going to do anything. It just puts a widget in students' hands, right? It's not going to change how teaching happens or learning happens. Assessment, oh my gosh, this is the one I don't have, no one asked me any questions about assessment. We have some answers, but not enough. When teachers started doing this, they'd go through this process. Students had great learning experiences, but it was never captured, right? It'd be like, and we're done. And there was no assessment of learning, right? And that's a problem. Students were keeping notebooks, but what do students put in their notebooks? How do we grade notebooks? There were a lot of questions that teachers needed to think about. There's lots of rubrics, right, that we can develop. Mohammed was sharing some curriculum with me this afternoon. We need rubrics. We need ways to assess. If you put the rubric right up here at the beginning, guess what happens? No innovation and no creativity, right? These students are smart. They're going to look at this rubric, and they're going to use this column, how to get an A, to do their design. And you've just lost all innovation and creativity, right? So figuring out where in the process to have the rubric is critical. And students are actually, it turns out, better at designing rubrics than teachers when it comes to STEM, right? If they're far enough into the process but not too far, they can tell you what a good design looks like because they know what a bad design looks like, right? Because they've made prototypes that don't work. So figuring out how to use rubrics and where to position them is turning out to be an interesting art that we have to work with. The last thing I'll say about assessment is until we change the way we do our national testing or our state testing, this is going to be really, really hard, right? There's these tests that students have to take, and as teachers, we get into trouble if the students don't do well on them, right? That's even true for us in Minnesota, where it's not a national test. It doesn't impact if the students get into college, but it gets published in the paper. My principal's going to be pretty mad if my math scores are low, right? And those tests are incredibly traditional, and they don't measure the things that we value, right, and the things that we need for our future. So we have a lot of work to do on assessment and a lot of policy work that goes with that, right? I think as teachers, you have some good ideas about how to assess student learning. The question is, how do we get the government to shift how we do that? Lastly, I want to thank a whole bunch of people, because I've told you a lot of things that I was involved in, but I was certainly not the only person involved. And funding from the National Science Foundation, Cargill, and 3M supported most of the work that I've talked about. Here's my Cargill fellows. I think you might recognize one of them there, who did a lot of work in the schools, a lot of research, and I've shared sort of highlights from some of that with you. And then this is some of our more current work where we're still working with Owatonna and some new, brand new schools in St. Paul Public Schools as well. And so these are mainly some of my new students here who are continuing some of that work. Betsy is one of the former STEM coordinators at the school. So when she lost her job, she came to get her PhD, and she's amazing. She really is. She's gonna be a great STEM coordinator somewhere as she moves on. And I'll leave with my email. So if you have any questions we don't talk about, feel free to email me. And I will take a breath and see if you guys have any questions.
Thank you so much indeed, Jill. Hands of applause. Very insightful presentation, and I'm sure there's a lot of things in your minds now that you want to know more about. But I think if one of the ideas was to open a STEM school, I think now we know how to do that and where to go. So let's open the floor for some questions and see how the discussion will go. So any questions? Ahmed. You may, really? Now?
Okay. In case you haven't realized, I know Mohammed.
Exactly.
So, yes, Mohammed.
I don't really need it. There's always been a gap that we're trying to bridge using.
Right, and make sure that you don't go too far to the skills space too. If you talk to people in Australia who are doing STEM, they've gone so far to the skills that there's a lot of pushback now. Right, their scientists and engineers are saying like, whoa, where'd the content go? Not because they're being traditional, but you can't be an engineer, right? I'll just focus on that one like piece of it. If you don't know, you have to know some content, right? The question becomes, how we teach and assess that content. What does it mean to know your content? Really becomes the question, right, as you start to think about instruction. And you don't know your content because you've memorized the periodic table. You don't know your content because you've memorized all the parts of the cell and their functions, right? I can still tell you the mitochondria is the powerhouse of the cell. I'm not actually quite sure what it does. It produces energy somehow. I think ATP might be involved. I can tell you like little facts about it. Turns out I don't really know it. Right? So we have to think about what it means to conceptually know our content so we can use the content. Right? And it's a balancing act of going back and forth. You can't do all project-based learning all the time because you do have to know some content to really, truly work in the real world. And there's just not a simple answer to that. It depends on probably the content that you're doing or the project that you want students to engage in. Right? So what you'll see a lot of the time is we teach the content and then we do a project at the end. That's fine, that's some way to do it. But if you start with a project, and we might have to stop and say, you know what, class? We actually need to know something about electromagnets. Let's stop for a moment. Let's learn that science and then come back to the problem that we're trying to solve, right? And that's part of the art of teaching, is it's going to be different depending on the grade level of the kids and the nature of the content you're doing, right? And there's times when you just need to do content, right? I taught chemistry. Students need to know how to name chemical compounds. I'm not going to mess with that. There's rules. We're going to learn the rules and we're going to follow them, right? I'm not going to do a project-based learning on that, right? So it's knowing how to move. And that's what the professional development is about, is because I can't answer your question directly. You have to learn it. You have to experience it. And it's like it's the difference between being a cook and a chef, right? Right? It's that art of teaching that you have to learn over time. So, nice question, Mohammed. Okay.
Minnesota and the schools.
Yeah.
Okay. And how would you define that partnership? I'm particularly interested in that. Yeah. And then the other, you talked about STEM being a response to employment needs. So what would be the lead content area?
Good questions. Okay, so the first one's about partnership. And how did we get involved and what was our involvement? It started back in about 2009 when the new standards were coming in, engineering's new, and everyone is freaking out. How are we supposed to teach engineering? We don't have curriculum, our teachers don't know how to do it. And there were a lot of meetings where people were getting together. And we had a meeting, and I couldn't even tell you who the speaker was. And I was sitting somewhere near the front because I got there late, and you only ever sit in the front if you're there late, right? So I'm in the front, and the speaker probably took longer than I did. I was in an uncomfortable seat, and I made a comment about how a part of my anatomy was a little numb as I got up and the speaker finished. And I'm a little loud, so people heard me say it. And the lady sitting behind me tapped me on the shoulder. She goes, "Oh, I don't think we've met. I know your husband. I work at 3M. My husband's an engineer at 3M. She goes, "I really wanted to meet you, and I want to talk to you about what's going on in some of the schools." I was like, okay. I know who this lady is. I've never met her. And if I want money, I've got to, like, very professional right now, right? So I'm listening to what she's saying. And her frustration was, as a company, we put a lot of money into the local schools, and we buy them stuff. We buy curriculum. We buy, you know, fab labs, equipment, whatever it might be. And I don't think they're actually using it. She's like, I don't know, what should I do? And I was like, well, let me tell you what I do. I work with teachers to help them improve their instruction. And when we work with teachers around something new, right, we do workshops and training with the teachers so they know how to use that thing that you just bought them. And so she shifted in that conversation her stance to how she funded, and she no longer gave money to schools to buy stuff unless they budgeted for professional development for their teachers. It didn't mean they had to go through me, right? That wasn't part of the deal, right? A lot of it did, but it didn't have to. But she had that aha moment at that point that it's not just about stuff, it's about people, right? And so they started to put money into teacher professional development, and when one company does something in town, then other companies start doing it, right? We're very blessed in where I live to have many large companies who have headquarters there, and they actually try and outcompete each other with giving money away, which is a great, great space to be, right? And so that became part of how companies started to think about that. And so with the money we had from 3M and the Cargill, when I listed those people, it was helping to pay for those people to be in graduate school, right? It helped Mohammed to eat, pay his rent, pay his tuition, right? And as part of that work, he was in schools for 10 hours a week working directly with teachers. It might be providing professional development, all sorts of different work that happened. So we were able to put resources into schools, right? Which is a benefit to the school. It's an amazing benefit to us because we now have access to schools to do research, right? So it was a win-win for everybody. So that's kind of how that happened. Right. And then your other question was about which content takes the lead with workforce development, right? It's not really content that wins there. It seems like, and the first reaction, and there's a lot of negative reactions to STEM, particularly from people who aren't science and math teachers, right? Of, oh, it's all about science and math. Well, it's not really. It's all about the 21st century skills. It's all about problem solving and innovation and communication and teamwork. Right? That's what, when you talk to businesses, what do they want? That's what they want, right? So my husband's a research scientist at 3M, and he hires people all the time, and he hires a lot of people from the University of Minnesota. And he was particularly irritated one day with one of his new employees, and he said, "Can't you do something about the engineering program at the University of Minnesota?" I was like, no, I have nothing to do with that, not my department. But his comment was, they're smart, they know stuff, but they can't do anything, right? If the machine breaks, they don't know how to fix it, right? They're supposed to be doing research and development, but they keep asking me what to do, right? He needed that problem-solving, creative thinking, right? And he's not the only one. That's across all of businesses. And so our business community is very involved in setting our standards. They're very involved in what happens in our university classrooms. And they've really pushed that, say, they still want students to take calculus and all of those things. It's not that they don't want that. They want us to produce innovators, right? Now that's quite a tall order, right? It's not like you can magically do that, but it changes the focus away from content. It's like my Hammer's question, that content versus skills. It's making us think more about those skills a little bit more and a little bit less about just how much, do I get through all the chapters in the chemistry book, right? Or do students learn to think like a chemist and only get through some of them, right? It shifts the conversation a little bit. Yeah. Sure. Mm-hmm. Yes and no. You can't have everything count as STEM, right? So some people, cooking's STEM. Cooking's problem solving, right? And you do some practices that kind of look like that, right? So you've got to lock it down a little bit. But if you lock it down too much, then it takes that creativity away from teaching and learning as well, right? So STEM's going to look slightly different. If I'm trying to do a project around, let's say, solving pollution and plastics is one of the things I saw at the STEM showcase, right? The kind of thinking and the kind of content I need to do to think about that problem is very different than if I'm trying to figure out like how to grow lettuce in a hydroponic space, right? So each project has a slightly different way of elevating different parts of STEM. So I like to work in the gray space. So I like nebulousness. So there was a question in the back here. Yeah.
Okay, I have 2 points, and I think they're related. First, you spoke about the NGSS, which are the standards for the science. For example, what about the math standards?
Really good, yeah, question.
Okay,
yeah.
So I know that the math follows the Common Core standards.
Yep.
And forgive me if I'm not up to date with how the schools do things in the U.S., but how could different school follow different or not follow any standards at all? And then each school would have its own set of standards that they would want to achieve.
And so we're seeing some spaces now. If any of you have sat for the GRE, delightful exam, and you have to type this essay up, and it turns into an analytical score that we all look at when we admit you into our programs, that's not graded by people. That's graded by a computer. Right? Now, I don't think it's at a point where I like completely trust that, but if we can get to a point when you can efficiently score something that's not A, B, C, D, then I think we have some hope. So what we're really trying to do is change the nature of the test, not get rid of the test. We're not going to get rid of the test. I don't think I could come up with a good argument really to do that. As much as part of me wants to, it would get really tricky, really fast. It would also increase a lot of the inequities we see in our system, right? So people who have access, you know, through wealth and where they were born are going to have better access to schools, right? And without something that cuts across, that's going to be really hard for students in those communities to then rise up. So the test can serve some good purposes as well.
Before we reach it, finally, to have a good STEAM system over the schools and society and understand and work with it, it will take time. After we reach that destination, then it will be...
tendency to change things before we've even figured out how to do something, right? A lot of schools will start an initiative, they'll do it for 2 years, go, that didn't work, and they try a new initiative. Like, we're constantly cycling through things. STEM's lasted a little longer than some initiatives, so that's good. For us in the US, that connection to business is so critical. Businesses are very clear about what they want in terms of 21st century skills, problem solving, and all of that, and STEM is able to deliver on that. I'm not going to say STEM's the only way to deliver on that, but it's one way to deliver on that, right? So I don't see it going away soon. The thing that I see that will actually sustain it is when, if we can get all schools to be doing STEM, do STEM schools even exist anymore, or is it just school? Right? So if we can normalize this kind of teaching, right? It's an approach, right? Right? So if I can get all schools to be doing problem-based learning and to think about solving societal problems, I don't have to name them as something anymore. It's just school, right? So, I mean, I guess that would be the big hope, is STEM schools don't exist because they don't have to anymore, because everybody does it. Now, that's not anytime soon, right? But, I mean, for as much work as I told you we do with these STEM schools, we do a lot of work with all teachers trying to promote this kind of instruction in all classrooms. Right, so I think inevitably it will be something else will come, right? But hopefully we leave that approach behind. So.
I was curious about STEM and STEAM, and you know, STEM alone itself has four subjects, right? Science, math. Mm-hmm. Technology, engineering. So a teacher would have content of all of these knowledge, or is it a collaborative effort? And also STEAM now. STEAM has, okay, these four kind of similar topic, and then you have A, which is like art, which is the, I think, core of creative thinking and critical thinking. So I think science teachers would be a little bit ambivalent about that A. So I want to ask you,
That's a great question. So I'll start with one of the other points you made, like, do I as a teacher need to have knowledge of all of these things, or is it collaborative? I think it's a little bit of both, right? So what we see in the STEM schools where we're seeing strength and continuity, and we're seeing school-wide implementation, all teachers are involved and they work collectively and collaboratively. So we'll see a project where the science and the math and the history teacher are working together. And then the next month I might come in and it's the science teacher and the English teacher working together. So having that ability to work and collaborate across disciplines really benefits. It benefits everybody, right? There's a reason engineers work in teams, because no one person knows everything they need to know for the project, right? And so bringing that idea to teaching is really important. As you do that and you start to understand STEM better, I become then better, I start to understand social studies a little bit better because I've worked with that teacher. So that enhances my own individual teaching as well, right? So it's a little bit of both there. Adding arts is tricky because it's not one discipline. The arts means a lot of things, right? It doesn't just mean, and if it, my first reaction was, heck, I can't draw. I don't know what STEAM is. Not doing it. I can't sing, I can't dance, not for me, right? But that's having a very narrow view of what arts is, right? Right, so about that aesthetic and that design. In many spaces, we've broadened arts to think about language and social sciences. So sometimes it depends what you mean by the A, right, as well. I've avoided it a little, I'll say, in the United States, because the A for us grew out of pushback against STEM. Okay? If you've never heard the term neoliberal, I've been called neoliberal more times than I can possibly imagine, which is a pushback from people saying, all you care about is workforce, business shouldn't drive education, right? I don't completely disagree with that, right? But if there's money to help learning, heck, I'm going to use it, right? And the pushback came of people saying, what about the arts? What about the arts? The arts are important. Yes, I agree. And then, but it became STEAM in a response to elevate art. It wasn't a purposeful thing. It was a political tension that happened. And that made it very difficult to deal with because you had all the, people took sides. Science versus art. It wasn't collaborative. It was us against them and like trying to jostle for funding. So it was actually very divisive initially in the US. As schools have taken that on, and some of them have chosen to add the A and some of them have not, right? McKinley, you saw, added that A because they started to see the value in it and said, well, we're doing it anyway, right? You can't solve real world problems if you only use STEM. It doesn't work, right? Because those real world problems are about people. Right? It's about psychology, and it's about how we live as a community. It's about politics. It's about all of those things. You can't avoid it if you do it well. Right? Other schools have said, it's more kind of like your question. it doesn't matter. We're doing problem-based learning. I don't have to rename it. I'm going to keep doing STEM, and of course art's a part of it. I don't have to call it out. So we're seeing a little less of STEAM in that regard, that some of it we just don't know how to deal with it, and some of it we're just like, well, STEM really just means multi-interdisciplinary. It isn't actually about those four letters for many people. So, and as you broaden it out, I'll just say one more thing. I saw one time, I wish I could re-find it now, something called a hamster school. Humanities, arts, math, see if I can spell hamster, science, technology, engineering, and reading. I'm like, isn't that just school? It gets a little silly, right, at some point as you start adding it.
So I was going to first ask for a commentary from the two Muhammads that you've been bringing up to the conversation, uh-huh, that I know they know you well,
right,
and they know this research, to see what the relevance, what are some of the aspects that they have gained from this talk, okay, that are relevant to the context here, yeah, to give us a little insight. Yeah. But also wanted to say that sometimes what lacks is people being able to see this STEAM in practice, and to me, it's always been an important, activist stand to have all this together. But it only became really evident when I started working with this STEAM that has pretty much all of these fields represented. And the artists that I included in that, it's an artificial intelligence related kind of a project, but we have dancers that are in this group. And at first you're like, why are dancers in this group? And then you have DJs, you have producers, you have all these different, so arts, many people don't really know what that is, but there's so many dimensions to the arts that until you see it in action, it's very difficult for you to actually conceptualize this idea of STEAM. So that, just wanted to say that,
So when I went to Minnesota, I went with a lot of experience from my work in STEM schools here. I was one of the people who initiated STEM experience in the Egyptian schools, and I had a lot of questions when I went there, but some of the questions were not answered, actually, because they're still developing. That's why I was asking Jill about the blurry definition of STEM education. It's still blurry and still has many meanings and still under development, and that's one of the things that I have learned. One of the big things I've learned, that you cannot have a clear-cut definition of any educational experience or approach. We need to work on, we develop, redesign, learn, develop, reflect, redesign, and learn, and that's a process of learning. So the biggest thing I have learned there is that when you go to the US, you will find people doing things similar to what you do here, but from their perspective. And the experience that I had with the school that they allege that they are doing STEM education, and then I went to the school and I didn't see any STEM, and then I asked the principal, "Is this a STEM school?" And said, "Yeah, this is a STEM school." So, but I didn't find any STEM over there, and he told me that I was doing this for funding, and that was like something that I, in Egypt, we don't have these things, because it's like everything here is financed by the government. We don't have all this stuff, but I learned that sometimes you can have the approach. The approach is not complete yet. It's under development, and it goes with your redesign reflection. And if it's not put in under ethical things, so the ethical constraints are very important, it can be prone to a lot of malfunction or just getting money for the sake of money. Is that okay to say that like this? Okay.
Do I need it? Okay, sorry, okay, sure. You can cover your ears, I'm okay with it. Okay, I just wanted to add another point on Nagdi's argument, is that when I asked my professors at the U what is education? I got a different answer every single class. Like, not only don't we have a clear definition of what is STEM education, we don't have a clear definition of what is education. So this is part of the beauty of it. And one of the things that I benefited the most from at the University of Minnesota is that each professor came with their own definition of what education is and created this learning environment for us. So in STEM education, I think the STEM courses we took were only 3 out of the 18, and the rest were cultural relevance, learning theories, psychology, sociology, anthropology, all sorts of stuff, which really, like, you can, they're giving you the tools and you shape it the way you, that would benefit your culture and your context. So this is what I really benefited from studying all of these different courses at STEM education, because four courses out of the 18. The rest of the courses were really, like, and it's amazing to see the diverse group of students talking about how they perceive education according to their own culture, their own context, and we are putting them in these different frameworks based on research, based on non-research, based on formal education, non-formal education, employment, all of these different things. So yes, STEM education as a brand, it gave us the opportunity to take the funding from the big companies and talk about learning and education, curriculum and instruction in a more meaningful manner. So.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And I would like to thank Dr. Gillian and Mohammed, who's been the audience, and everyone who came here today. I'm sure you have more conversations, probably. You've got Dr. Gillian's email and Twitter if you want to email her or ask her anything. And finally, I'll just say thank you again and a round of applause. Thank you so much. See you Wednesday. Okay, bye-bye then.